morning, everyone. Yes, my name is Pedro. I represent Channel 4. Channel 4 is a TV channel. It's one of the national channels in the UK, for those who may recognize the brand. It's a very iconic channel. It's considered to be very, very progressive, very innovative, because it has a very special way of doing things. And I'll give you more details later on. But as a way of introduction, let me just share with you a little video, so you know more or less what Channel 4 feels like.
He found it tremendously difficult to speak. He was incredibly badly teased.
Because he didn't have a voice then. And he's got one now.
To laugh is to risk appearing the fool. To weep is to risk being called sentimental. To reach out to another is to risk involvement. To expose feelings is to risk exposing your true self. To place your ideas, your dreams in front of a crowd is to risk being called naive. To try is to risk failure. To live is to risk dying. But the greatest risk in life is to risk nothing. The person who risks nothing, does nothing, has nothing, and becomes nothing. Only the person who risks is truly free.
Channel 4 was set up to take creative risks and put its profits back into programs. We were born to experiment, born to challenge, born risky. Very good, Mushy.
So, as I said, Channel 4 is a unique model in the way that we are a public service company, like TV or TV3 in Spain and Catalonia is. And we have to fulfill a public remit, but we also fund ourselves with advertising, as opposed to the BBC, who gets money from TV license. So we are heavily regulated by the government, and one of the things the government is asking us to do is really be innovative. And what we do is really get the money from we're getting from advertising and then reinvest it buying new content. And that content is normally bought to independent TV companies in the UK, small companies that couldn't really go and work with ITV, BBC, the big channels in the UK, but are really having the chance to really work with us. So we give kind of their money, and then they give us ideas. Our channel audience is very, very young. It's 16-34, so we are the young channel in the UK. And normally it's our market, so people who is wealthy and kind of high income. That means that for us, our audience is really, really embracing digital. It's people who are now changing their habits, and they're starting to watch YouTube instead of TV, or watching Netflix instead of watching us, or even just going on YouTube or kind of a Facebook or kind of a Twitter instead of just spending the time watching TV. So there was a realization from the senior management that we had to change. We had to transform our business from being a very traditional TV channel, one-way direction broadcasting, from one to many, to really have a digital way of working. And that's a huge transformation. I guess if you come from companies around here, it's changing from traditional to digital is a huge leap. And then that is what the data is really, really important in that leap, because data is really giving you the chance to create opportunities and minimize the threat. And that's what Channel 4 did 4 years ago. We embarked in this kind of a digital transformation, which has been fundamental. And the data function, which I lead, is being in the center of it. So I'm going to be giving you, telling you this history from those years back, and in the way that we have been using data to transform the business. I'm not going to be sharing with you any data models. I'm not a data scientist myself. I'm more a manager. But I think it's fundamental for you guys who are practitioners or researchers to understand how data will have to be used in the real business world, which may be different from the kind of academic world, kind of a more pure R&D world, okay? So I'm happy to give you more details on the models or kind of an analytics behind this, but this is going to be a very, hopefully, light and entertaining kind of a presentation, using a lot of videos, by the way, so I won't be talking that much. So the first thing to say is Channel 4 has got this app, which is called All4. In the UK, I think more than in Spain, TVs is starting to change and is watched more on video on demand, kind of is on demand rather than just linear TV, as we call it, kind of a traditional scheduled TV is kind of decreasing, and then people are really watching TV content using apps like the BBC iPlayer, All4 ITV Player. People really watch content on the train when commuting home, or kind of whenever at home they are using their tablets, game consoles, set of boxes to really watch TV content. All4 is all of that. So you can watch live TV on the internet. You can watch anything that is live on our channels on the app. But then you can also go back and watch any content that was available any time on Channel 4 using the app. You have 9,000 hours worth of content that you can have access to. All right, so kind of think about Netflix. I think we have even more content than Netflix has. And then you can go back in time and really, really watch. You can do some binging, box sets and everything. You can really do on All4. We want it to be not a catch-up service. It's like if you miss a show yesterday, I'll go and watch. It's more than that. We want it to be a destination, like YouTube maybe, and start exploring there. Okay, so it's All4 is what we got. And then all the data we collect normally now at this stage of our data kind of a strategy is coming from All4. Whenever you watch anything on All4, all your cookies are, all the web page is tagged, and all the cookies are captured through WebStream, and then really get all the data back. That's kind of our main source of data, as well as registration. I'll tell you a bit more about that. But you know, think about video on demand as our main data source, okay, for kind of what we do. And this is basically, you know, our first stage of the strategy, which is starting with registration. So we want people to really register with us. We're asking them to give us their details and personal details. When we know who they are, we are going to be tracking everything they do. And that is from browsing, searching, watching anything. Everything is tracked, and we know exactly what happens when people come to our website or apps. Then we start segmenting them using analytics, segmenting, using some recommendations, personalizations, using forecasting, optimization to really use the data we have to give value to the business. Could be providing a better experience, or could be just through advertising, which is obviously very, very key for us. We are using data a lot to really increase the price we charge for advertising to our kind of our media agencies and advertisers. All of this is based on our viewer promise. I'm not sure whether you know Alan Carr is a very famous comedian that, you know, is on our channel. And then our viewer promise is a value exchange. So we ask them to give them to give us their data, their kind of personal data, but we give them something back in return. And I will tell you a bit more about that. But you know, our viewer promise is just our promise to our viewers that we won't be using the data in the right way. Because again, we are a public service company. We don't want to do any dodgy with it. We just want to really use it for their own benefit. And the way we do this with our viewers is in the Channel 4 way, very, very plain, direct, and easy to understand. If you read Apple's terms and conditions, I think, well, I don't know whether you know the anecdote, if you know there's kind of these text robots on the internet that, you know, classify how complex a text would be, and then normally you get some scores, and apparently the Apple terms and conditions are even kind of more complex to understand than kind of a legal text from, you know, year 4 in university. So we are trying to use this video, not anything written down. It's going to be this video to tell our viewers what we want to do with their data. If it works. All right, sorry.
At Channel 4, we're deeply and passionately in love. We're in love with you, you lovely viewers, and we love making programs for you. We're so in love, we want to get to know you even better. Because to give you more of your favourite shows, not your mum's or your mate Steve's, it helps to know who you are and what you like. So, if you sign up with Channel 4, say 4OT, we'll ask you for your name, email address and a few other details. Now, I know what you're thinking. Why should you give us your name and inside membership? What will we do with that information? Let me put your mind at rest. When it comes to your details, we'll make you this promise. You control any personal information you give us. We'll never sell them to anyone. We won't clutter your email with stuff you don't want. And if you ever want the details you've given us back, we'll wipe them from our system. And you'll never hear from us again. Of course, having a better idea of who's watching our show does attract advertisers too, which helps us make even more shows. In case you didn't know, Channel 4 is a not-for-profit organisation. So, the money we make from advertising doesn't go to the pockets of shareholders. It goes into creating more great programmes we think you'll love. But like I said before, even though we're madly in love with you, you're the one who's always in control. You naughty little things.
For more information about Channel 4's viewer promise, go to channel4.com/4viewers.
So in return to their personal data, what we're giving them back is 9,000 hours of content. We're giving them the chance to download the content and then carry it with them on their laptops or their tablets or mobile phones. We give them season premiere so they can watch things online before on linear TV or exclusive content, just things that you can only watch on linear TV. Sorry, on online TV. We give them linear TV, and then we give also the rewards. So if you watch a lot, if you register with us, we may give you free tickets to watch premieres of movies or kind of get to know the cast and main kind of actors and actresses from different series, et cetera, et cetera. So we try to create a community and really give them some value in return of their data. As I said, you know, we have about 14 million registered viewers. That is one in two of the 1634's UK population. So that's almost half of our kind of our potential target audience in the whole country. And we ask for name, email address, gender, age, and postcode address from each one of them. Okay. Every time they come to our app or website, they have to log in, and then they can watch anything they want. So to give you an idea, and yesterday I think it was Twitter's 10th anniversary, I mean, in order to get to 10 million registered viewers in the UK, Facebook took 28 months at the time, Twitter did take 26 months, and we took 22 months, which is a phenomenal growth for us. So kind of we seem to be mobilizing our base very rapidly and in a good way. You may not be able to really see this for the very back, but this is our kind of this is how the story kind of how it's been panning out in the last few years. We started with registration, the real promise, in 2011. We are the first broadcasters, I think, in the UK, not even in Europe, I think in Europe, that are capturing first party data from registered viewers. And then we tested moving on, raising the base, creating the My4, which is the personalized area where you can really set your reminders, alerts. You can really put down, you know, the shows that you like, and then we keep you informed about these things. Reaching 13 million, and at this point is when the BBC launched a similar kind of a program with obviously less registered viewers. Kind of, they are 4 years behind us. And on the advertiser side of things, and what we're doing with advertisers, I'll give you more details later on, but you know, we're trying to develop new products and solutions, so yeah, we are starting to generate value from it. At the moment, 50% of the digital revenues from Channel 4 are coming from data-based products. And that makes us a benefit center, more a kind of a cost center. So we are now giving more money back to the business than the money is paying for us, which is a great place to be. And the plans are really to grow this. The market is very, very, very open to get this, you know, data-driven solutions. So kind of advertisers, media agencies really want more from this. And Channel 4 is really leading this space at this point. In terms of what we do in advertising, I'll give you more examples later on, but it's more for giving our kind of our viewers personalized advertising. They can really select the ads they want to see. We are creating new currencies, new demographics for advertisers to buy. We are generating interest targeting, like in the same of Facebook and Google are doing with their audiences. We are starting the programmatic world. I'm not sure whether you know about this, is you can really buy advertising through computers more than just people, which is the old school that is happening now. and coming back again to personalized ads, as I said before. I'll give you more examples now. Hope.
Now, I know what you're thinking. Why should you give us your name and inside management? What will we do with that information?
Hello, I'm Jimmy Farmer. Here to tell you exactly what we've done with that information. We've sold it to a Russian crime syndicate who are systematically copying every crime account they can get their hands on. I'm joking. We've actually offered it to a far more shady and illicit group, you. And you should be very excited about the opportunities coming your way. We now have over 9 million people registered with us. That's the entire population of Sweden. Not literally, you understand. That would be ridiculous, but fine. Not saying it wouldn't have benefits. All the information we've been collecting means we now know a whole heap more about who these people are and what they do. And this data has allowed us to fundamentally change the way your ads are targeted on 4OD. Rewind back to last year's upfront, where we shared our data vision with you. Well, since then, we've been working with 7 advertisers, trialing the first of our data-driven products, demographically targeted advertising. Before you bought ads on 4OD around program genres such as entertainment or comedy, now you can target specific demographic groups. Brazil. Now, call us weekend, but we had our suspicions. This was a great idea, and the results certainly didn't disappoint. On average, hitting a right target audience doubled click-through rates when compared to a standard 4OD campaign. Nokia's even tripled when they refined their audience targeting. And this also made the ads work harder. Ad recognition increased dramatically compared to a standard 4OD campaign, as did brand awareness. B&Q was able to increase top-of-mind awareness by a third, while recognition of a Unilever ad more than doubled, thanks to demo targeting. Finally, we found that on average, 4OD demo targeting is twice as efficient as our competitors at delivering the right demographic audience. Told you it was impressive, didn't I? And this is only the start. Over the coming months, we'll also be offering you targeting based around our users' interests, starting with groups like food, health, technology, and brand level. Okay, I made a lot of fun. But good stuff, right? And the best bit, you can get in on the action soon. Come and talk to us about how we can make targeting on 4OD work for your brand. Come on then.
So, as an example, I think we keep developing this, but demo targeting is a new currency we kind of created based on data. So before, TV ads were sold around the program. So kind of, it was a genre. So if it's a drama program, you will be selling advertising around that genre, and then advertisers will be buying spaces around the show. It could be entertainment, it could be kind of news, et cetera, et cetera. We created an audience that, you know, we recognize whoever is coming to watch the program, and we know exactly who that person is, whether it's a male, female, ABC1, which is a high social class, or a housewife, so the main decision maker in the household. And that is using data. We are using predictive models to really, based on their behaviors, we can really predict whether you are male, female, or whether you are 1634, or whether you are kind of a high class individual. We use, as I said, predictive models, and then we also use some sort of independent companies to really prove that the models are right, so we can sell it with a premium to the market. This was a test that we did before launching this, but you know, this is already making, it's about £20 million per year just on this product. And the KPIs are impressive. We also are developing interest targeting. So now, again, based on viewing behaviors, we can predict whether you like cosmetic, fashion, technology, whether you like eco or green products, and then we can sell these audiences with a premium to advertisers. And again, based on models and really accurate models, and then tested and kind of certified, audited by kind of our third-party independent companies as well. Very successful. And there we also using kind of personalized advertising. And I'll give you, this is, you know, we were the first in the world who did kind of this type of things, and hopefully the videos will play out very nicely. We won a Cannes Lion kind of award for this, which is the first ever personalized advertising for Coca-Cola. Remember this campaign where you had the bottles and you could see names on them? In this case, we knew everyone watching, so we kind of placed the name on that kind of a bottle when they were watching the ad. And people were impressed by the fact that they were just really, really looking at their name. Hopefully, it will play. So your name was Claire, or whatever name, you know, you had your name there. And people were quite impressed, and people were really clicking on this and then just finding out a bit more about campaign, et cetera, et cetera. So quite impressive. Obviously, people were concerned about, you know, why my name is there, and then you had to put this kind of a red box there just to say why my name is there, and then explain to them that, you know, this is part of our data program. A similar one for Burberry's. That's a fragrance company, and then they had a personalized edition where you could really have your initials on the kind of on the bottle. So I think the name there is going to be my boss's name and the boss's initials, because obviously we did it for her. But you will see people were able to really click on the ad and then just go straight to the website and buy the bottle with the initials right there. So Jill's is my name, my boss's name. Oops. Oh dear. I don't think that we've got the video. Maybe we need to. But I think they just sat down. I saw the video card. So Jill Whitehead is my boss's initials. So you had. And then you could buy all those bottles with their initials on it. And then that's your initials. Okay. Right, on the viewing benefit side of things, obviously we want to really help the commercial team with advertising and data, but also we want to really help the rest of the teams around the business with data. So we are trying to help the customer relationship team, or kind of the viewer relationship team, as well as the products team and the commissioning, a creative team. So we are working on a very huge recommendations program. We are using our own in-house data scientists to really work with algorithms to really fine-tune, you know, the right algorithms for our content. We are helping the team to really do personalized emails. So we, based on the viewer's history and what the viewing likes, we can really, really go for very personal communications with them. We can also do some marketing. Whenever there's a new show coming to the channel, we can really go and target that show to the specific audiences that we think are going to be liking the show, rather than just you know, promoting it to everyone. And also we're working on using data for rewards and engagement, you know, using churn models and kind of upsell, cross-sell models as well, to really help them to promote the content. Again, more than happy to answer any questions about the models themselves if you want to. We're using because, you know, this is a very creative business, and in here you have the problem with the art and science. So this is a very, very traditional TV business where people are very creative, you know, wearing very strangely flip-flops and shorts and everything. You know, the data for them is something completely alien. They just feel like, you know, it's very interesting, but they don't know how is it going to work with me. So it's always this battle with them in terms of, data can really help you. It's not going to substitute you. Machine is not going to be never making your decisions, but it can really, really help you. They're using the gut field to do anything at the moment. So the change is kind of, it's more difficult from the organization perspective than the technology perspective in itself. So we started 4 years ago, as I said. We tried Oracle and open source solutions, and I think it's from the week number two, number three, we just realized Oracle was not going to work, and then we went on to open source and AWS, starting to use Hadoop and R, and now we're moving into Python and Spark at the moment. Everything is very scalable and very quick because we can really start adding kind of a more kind of a more memory and capacity behind our technology. Again, team is really important for us. We have about 12 data scientists working in-house, very young people, has to be connected very well with the business. We are looking into kind of a cultural fit, very young data scientists. We have relationships with universities, so we are paying for PhD students and master's students so they come over to us, and then we're paying their fees, and then trying to nurture people from the bottom because hiring people is going to be is very difficult to us. As I said, we have about 12 data scientists, and then we have a figure which is called the data strategist, which is someone who can really talk to the business, can really go to meetings, send emails, do PowerPoints, and relate to the business trying to find the opportunity. When we get the idea, we send it to the data scientists who are kind of developing the models, and then that kind of model is taken back by the data strategist to the business, so we make a change happen. That's the structure, and it's working very, very well. The distinguishing between business engagement, data strategists, finding opportunities, the same language as the business, and the data scientists having the space and the time to really develop the models. And talent is really difficult to find, at least in the UK, and we have to really be conscious of this is a new type of people trying to work in this business and try to cater for them. So just to finalize my presentation, 4 points I want to leave with you. The first thing is that you want to really start engaging with your customers, viewers, and using data. Trust and control are key for them to really share the data with you. And that's really working fine with us. There has to be a value exchange. I give you something in return. Later, I also want to discuss, or to tell you about this. You always have to start with a business challenge in mind. And again, in the real big data world, you have to really have a business purpose with the data. You shouldn't start with the data and see whether you can find an opportunity. You have to really see what the problem is and try to help fixing it with data. Otherwise, you can get lost in, you try to find, the little kind of a golden nugget is going to be almost impossible. Define the problem and then try to find the solution using data. Also, it's very important to understand how the business works and make data science understandable. There has to be a connection between the data science and the business reality, and they have to really help with visuals, they have to help with the language, and using this data strategies in our case to really talk the same language as the business. It doesn't have to be perfect. We are not in this world where time is illimited. You have to deliver. So I think if even it's 80% good, just go and try and deploy that on the business and take the time to refine it along the way. Projects cannot really take months and months and months because we haven't really found the perfect solution. Just be practical, start with something, and then keep refining it. And the last point is about talent. In our case, if you want to build some data function capability in one business, talent is key. And I guess what you guys are doing in universities like this is great for the future of this industry. That's me. Thank you.
As Pedro said, in film and in television, there's a lot of very traditional people who have a very traditional mindset of how to do business. And I'm going to take us back to that more traditional side for a bit. And in keeping with tradition, I'm foregoing PowerPoints and sticking to the traditional blackboard to help iterate how traditional the business is. So my name is Matthew Eric Basset. I work for a company called Gower Street Analytics. And Gower Street Analytics is not a consultancy company. We're an independent software vendor for the film industry. We work with studios, with film distributors, with production companies, with talent agencies, and with cinemas. We call them exhibitors, but you would know them as cinemas. And if you hear me say exhibitors, just change it in your mind to a cinema. We work with all these companies, and we produce a software package for them that can help them manage their products from a data perspective. And as Pedro said, when you're in industry and you're working on data science problems, you have to start with the business problem. You have to start with a business question and work your way to the data science problem from that. Because everything is really driven by the business, by the revenue of the company, and you must understand where the money's coming from and the whole business process is working. The software we develop understands how the film industry works. It understands the production side, the talent side, the exhibition side. And what it does is it opens up to studio executives, all the film industry executives, a whole new world of data for them, so that when they're doing their job, they now have actual data inputted into their business decisions. Pedro mentioned that many times TV producers, and it's the same in film, are making decisions based on their gut. They have an idea of what's the best time to release a film, what sort of film they should release for this market. They make it on their gut and they kind of hope for the best. And sometimes they win, sometimes they lose. We're changing that industry and injecting data into every part of the process. And just to give you an idea of how the process looks like. So how the film industry works. When a film studio, and I'm going to talk mostly about Hollywood film studios and leave some of the smaller independent production companies that you would have in France or Germany or Turkey out. They will start this green light process where their executives are going to see some pre-production footage of a film, maybe read a script and decide if they want to release this film. After they've decided they want to release it, or if they decide they're interested, they call up a team back in their office, their analytics team or their research team, and say, hey, I just saw this great film at this film festival. It looks really good. How much money do you think we can make off of it? And their gut starts working. They start digesting their food and coming up with some numbers. And then it goes to this dating process. And this dating process is it's an international process, but it's driven primarily in Hollywood, in LA, where the studios are based. And it tends to be very US-centric, because let's be honest here, your gut, if you've been working in the US for 30 years, your gut on the US market is really, really good. You tend to have trouble on the rest of the world, but the rest of the world is so much smaller than the US. At least that was the case 20 years ago. Modern times, the US takes about 40 to 60% of the international box office market, and the one half to two thirds come from the rest of the world. But the rest of the world's so complicated. I mean, they speak different languages, and you know, there's people of different skin colors, and it's just very complex, and you don't have a very good gut for that. So this dating part becomes a lot more complicated. They know when to release a film in the US, but how do you know if your next Minions title or Finding Dory, how is that going to interact with your local competition in France? How's it going to interact in China? Lord knows how it works in China. Or India. India's an even weirder question. But after the dating side, this is really where the decision-making process kind of stops and the machinery of the studio takes in. There's still lots of marketing decisions going on, but at this point, we know we're going to release a film. We have a date. The marketing people just start driving forward. So they're making the trailers, making the posters, deciding where to put their advertisements on the side of a bus in London or on a billboard in Los Angeles, and they just go with it. They then start doing these publicity campaigns, which is very much like your marketing, but it's a little bit more specific. Your publicity is where you're going to take the talent, the actors and the directors, the cast of the film, and you're going to have them doing your talk shows or showing up at the premiere in a specific country, talking to the fans and building up excitement for that film. This can have a huge effect. For one Hollywood film that happened to have a Brazilian actor, once they finally realize that the Brazilian actor is really popular in Brazil, that the marketing campaigns were skyrocketing once they realized that this person should be doing publicity in Brazil and not in the US, where nobody has heard of them. After publicity, we finally make it all the way to the cinema. And at this point, the film now meets the audience. Everything here we've discussed, everyone is making a decision off their gut. Nobody, the film has never reached an audience. It might have seen a focus group, but it hasn't. We really haven't got any data on how the audience interacts. And here we're now getting some information about the audience, but the film is also facing all of the competition, not just from other films playing at that cinema, but it's facing competitions increasingly from video games, from TV, not just linear television, but television you might be watching on demand from Netflix, any of your box sets. It's facing competition from sporting events and a host of other things that there's very little information to track. Now, Gower Street Analytics tries to helps the industry from this point onwards. And we start here on the dating decision. One of the things that we've done at Gower Street Analytics, our first software package that we're selling to studios right now, is a simulation based on this dating question. The question we started with, and it doesn't even sound like a data-driven question, but it's, what happens if we're going to release Fast and Furious in Russia? I'm using Universal titles because I came from Universal Pictures. What happens if we release Fast and Furious in Russia at the same time Fox is going to release their title? Or what happens if we're going to release Fast and Furious same day everywhere internationally on the same weekend as Hangover 2? Are these films going to interact? Are they going to hit each other? Are they going to compete? Or will it be fine? The traditional gut answer is that Hangover 2 is a comedy, Fast and Furious is an action film. So there's not really much of a competition there. They won't interact. In practice, if you start going into the demographics, and we talked a lot about demographic-specific advertising before, but if you look at the demographics of the film, they're attracting more or less the same audience. So they tend out to be competing heavily. Now, if you have one case like this, the traditional process, the traditional way of doing business when they have this question, is your analyst will sit there with your Excel spreadsheets, and we heard somebody mention that these need to go away earlier. We have these Excel spreadsheets, and they start spending a couple of days, a couple of hours, sometimes a couple of weeks, going through their numbers. They'll bring up their historical decays of a film. A decay is kind of when we talk about decays, we mean a time series. Initial release, week one, week two, and people tend to give it an exponential curve because this is what their gut tells them. They start plugging in all their decay curves and coming up with a number for its opening weekend, its lifetime, how it's going to do in week two when another film enters the market, and so forth. And this is a very complicated process, especially when you end up with 15 different Excel spreadsheets. Some are tracking the weather in Russia when you're releasing. Some are tracking the competition. And you start to miss things, and it just takes too long. So Gower Street Analytics first tries to answer this question by managing all this data that goes into this process, but also implying some machine learning onto it. One of the first things we learned at Gower Street Analytics is this sort of exponential decay curve. I'm going to change this just a tad. This x-axis is percentage, by the way. It's not actually an exponential decay curve in most cases. Films tend to fall into categories. You can kind of do a k-means clustering, and you'll end up with a couple different clusters. Sometimes you get a nice exponential decay curve. Sometimes you get a very steady cycle and then a drop-off. And other times you'll get something kind of slow, a little peak, and then it disappears into oblivion. So what our models are able to do, but the first thing they do for the dating decision is, since we know that we need to, in order to come up with this lifetime number, we need to be looking at the competition week by week and day by day. So if anyone has done any research in this area before, you might be familiar with a couple academic papers that say you can predict box office market in the US, the lifetime gross. It's gross for its the full time it spends in cinema by looking at the number of Wikipedia edits. That prediction, just as the lifetime, it doesn't do a weekly decay, and it actually doesn't give a precise regression number. It's categorizing them, saying this is going to be a $10 million film, this is a $100 million film, this is a $50 million film, and so forth. That's not very useful to the business because we're trying to see it's week by week competition. So we have to predict week by week. And we start off with that lifetime prediction that we have seen on saying this film is going to make X much lifetime. But then we try to classify, and we turn it into a classification problem instead of a regression problem, which one of these curves it's going to be. This information goes into a simulation, and that's now a data-driven simulation. So when studio executives log onto our software and they start interacting with the system, they can ask these questions that say, what happens if we move Star Wars to the same date as a James Bond film? Nobody would do that. That would be ridiculous. But say you wanted to ask that question. They now have a quantitative answer instead of a gut-filling answer, and they have it instantly rather than within a couple of weeks when their analysts figure it out and they've forgotten that they've asked a question anyhow. And the cool thing about any supervised machine learning is that we can answer those questions instantly, because all the difficulty goes into training the models the night before or the week before when you're building the model, and you're always shipping to your customers a system they can actually use. But that's a software engineering thing I don't want to go into too much. This simulation, now that they're asking these questions and able to get some answers, helps them solve this dating problem on whether they should release this film, release Fast and Furious to compete with Hangover 2, or whether they should back off, or whether they should compete with Hangover 2 in some markets, but back off in other markets. And once that decision is solved and they've picked a date, and this happens 6 months before release, before you have any data, we now start talking to the marketing campaigns. And the marketing campaigns, they have a lifetime gross from the studio executives of how much they want this film to make. Even if you're a local independent and you acquire a film at a film festival, you buy that content, you see a film you like, you buy the distribution rights to it. Even if you're doing that, you have a base number that you have to get to. We've got to make $1 million off of this film or $5 million off of this film, or we're hosed, right? We're going to lose money. So the marketing campaigns know that they have this number, and this number drives the whole process. They'll say, all right, Fast and Furious needs to make $500 million internationally. How do we get there? And this is, again, not a data-driven process, but they start breaking these things down by demographic and saying, all right, if we're going to make if we're going to make $500 million from this title, we're going to need to make this amount of money from your young college-age peoples in this territory. We're going to need to make another $100 million from people in 30 to 35 who only go to the cinema once a week. And they start classifying into different demographics and different categories of an audience and going through them. Again, this, like I said, this is their traditional process. And this business question that Gower Street tries to solve, because it's always about the core business question that you want to answer, is, given a box office gross, what is the most optimal breakdown of that demographic in order to reach that number? And this is where, again, we start turning things into a data science question. The simulations I talked about, I made it sound like they're working on a territory level, but they're actually working on a per cinema level. We still do not have any odd information about the audience. We never have. Gower Street never gets it. And at the marketing side, we still don't know. But we have information about how every single film has done on almost all cinemas across the world. So we will know if your first Fast and Furious did really, really well at a cinema in Crewe in England. There's an Odeon Crewe, it's got 5 screens. Fast and Furious did really well there. I made that up, by the way. Or if it did really badly at a cinema in Barcelona, we have that information. Using this information, we then have another data model that's built on top of this to see how the demographics of film is breaking down per demographic in different cinemas. And we're kind of inferring the demographic breakdown by knowing, does this film always do really well on action films? Does this film always do really well on children's films? And after the release date information's come in, we can go back and check our answers. So we have a process to see, to build up this demographics cinema-specific model that can then fill in the marketing campaign. And something very similar is publicity. When it comes to a publicity campaign, the question we're trying to see is, what is the best way for us to spend our money on getting the cast about? And this is somewhat of an easier problem, but this is where a lot of social media comes in, and we're not a social media listening company, but this is where you can start following people on Twitter and start getting a very strong signal on where this person is geographically strong. And you can start answering that question. The final slide, and I think how am I doing?
You're having 3 minutes.
Yes, great. So the final slide, once things get to the cinema, things also get a little more interesting. Finally, we've reached our audience, and we're getting some information on our audience. The pollsters are coming in. We know who's watched the film. That information goes back into our supervised models. Our models adjust to that, so we know where we've made our mistakes. But things get a little bit different here. The cinema delivery, when a cinema gets a film, is nowadays a completely digital process. They press a button, satellites transmitted to a secure network, and the cinema has to film, and they can swap out movies several times in an hour if they want to play at all screens. But the process to book films on a screen is a very old traditional process, where a studio executive, a sales guy from the studio, from the distribution company, calls up the cinema, they argue, they say, I want Fast and Furious on every single screen this weekend. It's going to blow all the competition out of the water. And they say, well, we've got this other film, and we made these deals. And the question the whole industry is asking is, what's the best way to put all these films on screens that will make everyone the most amount of money? And this is a very game theoretic problem. You know, if you have a children's film and an action film, what are the best scheduling times so that they both do well? Neither people really like the situation. Studios are always pushing for it. For one side, they want their screens everywhere. Nobody wants to back off, even if they make money somewhere else, because they don't have any data to back up that they'll make money somewhere else. Gower Street Analytics, as it's simulating every single cinema, and we have these machine learning models, tells them, you actually should back off, because you will make this money off. You should back off on Fast and Furious. You will make it up on another film, because later on this year, your children's film won't be facing that much competition because you picked a really good date. The other thing that comes on here is when cinemas are reporting their grosses back, when the cinemas start reporting their grosses back to the studios, are these grosses actually in line? Are they matching what you would expect for a film that's grossing as much as internationally? Which is kind of a more difficult question because not all cinemas are honest about their grosses. Sometimes they make mistakes. Sometimes people are being very bad. And there's some fraud detection and anomaly detection that goes on to let know what's going on in the cinema to know if the numbers coming back are accurate and look right. And I think that's all my time, so thank you very much.
Okay, good morning. My name is Sharon, and I head up the analytics, marketing, and customer experience at Social Point. I'm going to talk to you today about how we change the game at Social Point. All of our products are free at Social Point, so increasing revenue is an interesting challenge for us that I want to talk to you about. Before I do that, let me tell you a little bit about Social Point. So we make games for mobile devices, for phones or for tablets. Who has played a game on their iPhone or their phone or their tablet? All right, so most of you know what I'm talking about. This is Obama playing our latest game, Drain Land. You too can download it for free from the App Store. If my talk is not interesting, feel free to go onto the App Store and download it. Unfortunately, this is not a real picture, I should say. We did Photoshop it. I would love that he played our games, but so far we haven't been able to buy him. Okay, so all our games are free to play. Let's take a look at them. Right now we have 4 games available in the Apple App Store and the Google Play Store. We launched World Chef in January of this year. It's a more female-targeted game, gives you the chance to own your own restaurant. It's currently in the top 100 grossing in terms of revenue in the US, which is our biggest market. Monster Legends is a male-dominated game. It's more about battling and combat. It's currently around about top 70. And Dragon City is our most popular game. It's been live in the App Store for 3 years now. And we've had 200 million people download Dragon City. It's usually in the top 50. And last week, or the week before, we just launched Dragonland. It's our latest game. Social Point is a company that started here in Barcelona by two people from Catalonia, so it's a real success story for the region. We currently make, I can't tell you the exact figure, but over $100 million every year from gaming. We are one of only, I think the last time I checked, 8 companies worldwide who have more than one product in the top grossing revenue ranks. Let me just show you one of our games.
Welcome to your new delicious game. Create your own restaurant and fill it with world-class chefs. Serve the finest cuisine and please your customers. Decorate the place to your taste. Style is key. Expand your world. It's easy as pie. World Chef. Download now for free.
Okay, for those of you who are listening, you might have heard me say that we make over $100 million. And you might have also heard me say that all of our products are free. So how does that work? And in fact, if we look across the global industry for mobile gaming, $75 million will be made daily by gaming companies. In fact, $1 million will be made in my industry in the time that it takes me to give this speech. And yet all of our products are free. So how does that work? Is that a paradox or a deception? And it's not advertising, I should say. A very small percentage of our revenue, less than 10%, comes from advertising. So how does this work? Well, it works because a very, very few percent of the people pay. The vast majority of people who play mobile games do so for free. Across the industry, 98% of people or so pay nothing. We lose money on 98% of you because it still costs us to deliver the game to you. But a very, very small percentage of people choose to pay. At least for Social Point, we don't have any blockers in the game that make you pay. You can enjoy the full content of the game for free if you want to do so. But you can also choose to pay through in-app purchases if you want to do that. So all of our analytics is about finding that white stone or that very small percentage of the population that will choose to pay in the game. So we ask ourselves a lot, why? What makes people pay? What are the reasons that some people will pay inside of our game? We have some hypotheses on this. We think the first reason that people pay is to elevate their social status. In some ways, to say, I am better than you, at least in the virtual world. And there are two ways of displaying that. One is through competition. In Clash of Clans, which is the top revenue-grossing game, you can join a clan and play against other clans. In Monster Legends, you can join an alliance, and your alliance can fight with other alliances. So there is some social coercion that you want your team to do better than other teams. So you want your clan to be better than other clans. You might also want to show off in your virtual world. So in Dragon City, a lot of people focus very much on collecting all the 400 dragons that we have, and then they'll tell the world on social media, I now have the full set of dragons. Or in the World Chef game, we encourage and people like to decorate their restaurants and show their flair, at least in an online restaurant. They're showing off their personal style. How do we know that social status is important to revenue generation? Well, we know that the average revenue per user for those that are socially connected and connected via a social network is 2 times that of non-social players. The second reason people will pay is because they get impatient. They can't wait. And there's 2 reasons why the game might be too slow for them. The first is that they might not be very good. This is actually a picture from my game, from Dragonland. I'm not very good at Dragonland. And you can see my dragon just here has died. So I can save him by spending in-game currency if I wanted to do that. So we know that not being very good at the game slows it down for you. We also know that the games are sometimes designed to create waiting times to slow it down. So this is a picture from our Monster Legends game. If you want to complete the habitat for your monster, it will take you 2 hours for that to happen. Some people don't want to wait for 2 hours and they will spend in-game currency to make that go faster. Now, how do we know that impatience is important? Well, one of the things we looked at is the probability of someone making 2 or more real money transactions in the game. For players that are low skilled, they are 150% more likely to make 2 real money transactions. Okay, and finally, some of our customers have an emotional connection to the games. They love their dragons or their monsters. This is a real fan letter we got from a child playing the game. You probably can't read the text, so I wrote it out. It says, I wanted to let you know how much I love Monster Legends. My favorite character is Dr. Hazard. I am going to be him for Halloween. He then sent us a picture of his Halloween costume dressed as Dr. Hazard the monster. It was very, very cute. But for sure, there are some players who get emotionally connected to the game. We have people write to us if the game has to go down for some reason while we're doing maintenance, write to us and say, I miss my dragons. When is the game going to be live again? So this is one reason why people pay. Okay, so that's all the psychology of it, but this is a big data conference. So where does big data come in? Well, certainly we have big data. We collect about 3 billion pieces of data every day. But why do we do that and how do we use it? The first thing we do as an analytics team is try very hard to make the game fun. And why do we do that? Well, we know that people who play more, this is the number of sessions per day, the number of times they open the game, is correlated with spending more in the game. So players who have fun or at least spend more time in the game do tend to spend more real money as well. But perhaps more importantly, players who don't have fun will probably stop playing the game, and then there's no chance that they will play in the game. So how do we look at the analytics of fun? How do we decide if the game is fun or not? Because fun for me is probably very different from fun to you. Well, we actually turn it around the other way. It's quite hard to define what fun is. It's a little bit easier to think about what is not fun. And generally, things that are not fun are the same for most people. So we look a lot, we spend a lot of time trying to detect if there are any problems in the game. We are constantly updating and changing the game, and any update can potentially include a technical problem. So we look through all of the tickets, the reviews, any written information about the game, and we are looking to, over time, we do this every hour, pass the data and see if there is something that's trending. In this case, you might not be able to read it, but here, anniversary as a word suddenly got bigger. This was when we launched a birthday surprise for Dragon City, and it was an anniversary dragon that you could get in the game. Unfortunately, though, there was a technical problem with the anniversary dragon and people weren't receiving it, and you can see it spiked. That enabled us to fix that problem very quickly. Within 24 hours, we had released a new version of the game back out to the public. The other way we look at it is finding what a bad experience is for the customer. So we get about every 2 seconds through the game, we get a checkpoint to see where the customer has reached. And what this is showing you is the percentage of customers that have reached that checkpoint. If there is a discontinuous break in that series, then we know they're is likely to be an issue with that particular step. We'll go and play the game. We'll try and hypothesize why the user is having trouble or doesn't like that bit. I can give you an example. In one of our games that we were just testing, we discovered that there was one particular step that people were closing the app. And when we played it and looked at it, it was a step in a tutorial where we were trying to teach people to play the game, and we were encouraging them to spend in-game currency to teach them how to do that. However, we hadn't explained to the users that this was not real money, that we were not asking them to spend real money in the game, and people thought we were, and so they were closing the app. It was a very easy change. We just enabled to change the text to explain to people that this was just a tutorial, this was just a way of teaching, and it was no real money. In fact, we were giving them the currency to spend, and immediately we solved the problem. Okay. The other thing that makes games not fun is if they're too difficult or if they're too easy. So we spend a lot of our time looking at, is the game too difficult or too easy? Now, that's super difficult because what's a difficult game for me might be an easy game for you. So we spend a lot of time looking at this. I don't know if you know who PewDiePie is, but I'm afraid to say we don't spend money on TV. We spend money on YouTube advertising our games. PewDiePie is the number one, in terms of revenue at least, celebrity on YouTube. We pay him to play our games. And this is a clip from when he and his girlfriend played our latest game, Dragonland.
Okay, now Maya's gonna fly.
I don't have the fly ability! She doesn't have the fly ability!
Oh my
ability.
God. Go, Maya, you can do it! Come on, Maya! Double jump!
Wait, okay. I thought it.
She's too fat to. Oh! How many times are you gonna kill our dog?
It doesn't matter.
Oh! Oh! You gotta wait longer than that.
Wait, what? I die? No, you could
let
die. Why do you think you will be better than me at this?
Look, first try, alright? First try. Why did I die?
First try, huh?
Second try! Anyway, I changed my mind.
That was actually his dog that they're playing with. He has two dogs. We actually put his dogs inside the game so that he could play with them in the video. But you can see the game is probably too difficult for his girlfriend. It's pretty funny in the clip, but that's not actually what we want to see, that the dog dies that many times. So if we were to see that in the analytics, we would change something in the game. And we are moving towards dynamically adjusting the difficulty of the game in response to how the users are playing. Okay, once we've made the game, or taken out all the things that are not fun in the game, the second thing we want to take out is any transaction barriers. I'll let you figure out.
Does it come from
you? Oh, there we go. It's back again. And one of the transaction barriers is inability to pay. So we sell the game globally. And the game is priced the same globally, so that means that it's relatively more expensive to pay in our game if you're in a developed country. For people that are or don't want to pay, we do offer the chance to watch advertising. This is purely a choice that you make. Inside the game, we have this area that's called Monster Wood. If you choose to go into Monster Wood, you can watch a video and receive in-game currency for that. So that helps us get over the problems of people being unable to pay. The second problem we might have sometimes is lack of trust. It always strikes me as odd that we're willing to go into a store and pay 60 euros for a console game that's wrapped that you don't get a chance to try. But for some reason, we trust Sony is going to deliver us a great experience, and we're willing to pay 60, 70 euros for that. On the other hand, We have issues where the users don't feel that they can trust, even though our prices are $2, $5 maybe. So we want to overcome that, overcome the first payment hurdle and get them used to making transactions in the game. And finally, they may have sticker shock. Even though our prices are low, maybe they're not low enough. And so what we do to overcome these two things is we offer starter packs quite early in the game with discounted offers, much lower prices, to try and get people used to making transactions in the game. Things like this, we will A-B test a lot. But A-B testing in our world is a little bit difficult. Very little of our data is normally distributed. Most of it looks like this. So as I told you before, 98% of people pay zero. And then we have some very, very few people who pay a lot in the game. If you pay a lot in our game, we call you a killer whale. And we have to be careful how those killer whales are distributed across the groups that we are testing in. If they end up in one group, it can distort our results. And because our data is not normally distributed, we also have to be very careful with the statistical significance testing that we are using on A-B tests. Okay, so once we've removed the things that are not fun, we've removed the transaction barriers, then what do we move to? Well, this is where we try to bring the psychology and the analytics together, and we try to match the reasons that we think people are paying, or categorize them according to why they are paying, with their ability to pay and offer targeted product offers to them. So to give you an example, this young man is very competitive. He wants to win. He's employed, so he can pay. We may offer him a product offer that gives him the ability to power up his dragons so that he can fight better in the next battle. Or we may have a child playing the game who has an emotional connection, like our Dr. Hazard fan earlier. But unfortunately, he does not have any ability to play. We may then suggest that he watch an advert to monetize that way via the game. Okay, so that's it really. Our product is free. It really is free for most people. But we do have a few small percentage, 2% of our people that will pay. We think they pay. So that they can compete against others to show off, to progress faster in the game, or because they really, really like the game. And then from an analytics perspective, we start by checking the game, fixing the game, making sure it's fun, removing transaction barriers, and matching customers to the right product offers. But it's always challenging because always, and though we have 3 billion pieces of data every day, we're looking for those 2% of people that will pay in the game.
Can I have a few questions actually for the whole of the panel before we take the next one?
I have a question for Matthew because I was very interested in the part of dating, and it looks to me like an impossible problem to solve with any, you know, whatever method you like in your toolkit. Because you depend on what others are going to do with respect to the dating, and therefore you have to predict the dating that at the same time depends on your choice of the dating. So there is a reflection from that, and it's a game theoretical setup where you are not sure who are the other players, you don't know what movies are going to be around, what days are going to be.
So that's a theoretical problem that doesn't appear that much in practice. For if you have a film like Star Wars, it creates its own market. If you release Star Wars on the sleepiest Tuesday in a year, and only one cinema in all of Spain, people are still going to find that cinema and watch Star Wars. So it creates a market. And a weird analogy, but if you think of space-time and how a massive object distorts space-time around it, films are kind of behave the same way. A massive film distorts the whole market around it. And then the bits where you're going to have these dating questions are your mid-range titles. So a dating decision isn't going to take a 10 million title and turn it into a 100 million title, but it could take a 10 million title and turn it into a 15 million title. So you only have a handful of titles that actually matter. Everything else is set up to market. And those handful of titles, they don't interact that much. You kind of know when your competitor's going to do it. They kind of know when you're going to do it. They see you change a date. And sometimes you'll get into situations where you're changing a date to showing weakness, and then you end up having the reverse effect because you're changing the date signals that you don't think it's good content. But that's a pretty rare case. I'd say about 70% of the time, it's safe to start playing with your dates.
But it looks like if you collude with the other companies, everybody's going to be better at home. And so,
well, we don't use that word collusion.
Okay, now, yeah. If you talk to a lot of people about, what is the best day perhaps to have the field release and what, sounds like that is the solution.
Yeah, I mean, the overall solution would be if you have, nope, you shouldn't release all your children's films at the same time.
Right.
And this collusion problem is something that the Chinese market uses to protect their own industry. So they control the release dates for Western films, and they will take all your big Western action films and make them release on the same day so that none of them get any market share, and then leave the market wide open for their own titles. And that's how they're trying to develop their own industry and protecting it from outsiders. They just let outsiders come in just enough to get inspiration, but not enough to make money. And outside of the world, the collusion would be, that's the perfect solution, but that's not the legal solution, and that's not the solution that anyone's going to actually do. But you can see, if you've got this title, let's take a title like Les Miserables, Les Mis a couple of years ago. It's sometimes not even competing with the other items on the market. Sometimes it's just competing with everything else that's going on. There was a case where in Les Miserables, we released that on Christmas in the US and in Australia, but removed it after Christmas in the UK based on dating partially on these models. It did what the model is going to say in all three cases. In the US it did an okay number, in Australia it did an okay number, and in the UK it did an amazing number that broke records for that weekend. Just because the model is able to detect moving this date over here, you're avoiding a lot of the non-film competition and people just have more time to see your content. So theoretically, yes, it's a big problem, but in practice, it's not just the films we're competing against, it's everything else on the market, the video games release, holidays, shopping events, all of that goes into it as well.
Other questions? I should have two questions. One is, you said companies take into account about 6 months before the release date, when they're going to release the film, but we've seen in the last years, especially in action movies, that they try to build the hype for what's going to come in the next 2 or 3 years, and we know almost exact dates. That's the first question. Why is that happening?
Let's go for the first one, and then the second one.
I have a short memory and I would have forgotten your second,
exactly,
your first question. So what you're saying is definitely true, and if you look at a market like the US, which is much easier to predict, you will have almost a full slate of dating decisions 18 months out and 24 months out. Partially, this is just because if they think they have a big title, if they're investing a lot into it, if they spent $200 million in production on this title, they think it's one of these large titles that are going to shape the market. So they're kind of stenting their claim now and saying, this is my planet, the whole gravity of the market should warp around me. You'll do that with Star Wars. So your large action films do behave that way, but again, these mid-range titles don't. I say 6 months out, but if you have a small enough title, a $10 million title in a market like France or the UK or in Germany, you might change that release date a good 6 weeks out, especially if you're an independent distributor and you have a small title, it had a small production budget, but you know there's a local audience for it. You might change that even 6 weeks out just because you don't have the marketing campaign invested on that date. You're a lot more nimble.
Let's take another question.
But I had a question for Ben. Thanks very much for you talking on the very interesting room when I felt like in a Black Mirror chapter for a few minutes sometimes. Basically, my question is, I think I missed something. You said you just had very few fields and you were collecting data and they were very basic, like name, email, location, gender, and something else. Then you were talking about housewives or social classes. So how did you actually infer this from this five or six?
So the real data is the behavioral data. So how people behave tells about a lot about them. So it's a trained model. So we normally kind of run a survey, say 10,000 people from our register base, and then we ask them, answer these questions, and then we define whether they are not or they are housewife. And then looking at how they behave, we can really go to the base and then really, really train the model, which can predict us.
Yeah, it's an inference. It's not that they have to answer it.
No.
So you could be wrong at some point.
Yeah, well, we build a model with a certain level of accuracy that, you know, is
it's be not a housewife that has housewife's behavior.
Correct. There is always a certain margin of error, but it's within the industry, and because we certify that with the auditors, kind of is accepted.
Do you find any pattern in the users that are paying these 2% of contribution? And these payments are overrider sources, or the user who is paying is playing a lot of life?
Do we find any pattern? Generally, they play a lot more than the non-payers, and you saw that in the number of sessions. And they tend to be worse at the games. So yeah, crappy players, but really love the game. So those are the two things that we find. It makes a difference if they're playing on an Apple device or an Android device. People who have an Apple device are much more likely to pay than people who have an Android device.
Pay the really lot. So.
Yeah, keep paying.
Question is related to that. I mean, your business model could be expressed to reach instead of 2%, 5% of a sort of volume.
There's all,
and
yes.
You put in risk your actual model. I mean, you're going to lose clients. I mean, did you have some kind of scenario analysis performed?
Yes, we do look at, we could force people to make a choice between paying and stopping playing. And other games will do that. They will put a point in the game where if you want to keep playing that game, you have to pay in real money. At Social Point, we've always taken the view that that's not what we're interested in. We provide fun. We want people to keep playing the game. So we will never put that kind of blocker in the game that you have to pay to keep playing. So for us, there's always that balance between monetization and increasing revenue and decreasing fun. And we want to make sure that we're on that line. And in fact, we go a little bit towards making sure the game is fun and keeping people playing. And that's why Dragon City has been in the market for 3 years, even though the normal life cycle of a game is quite short.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, one question is for Pedro. I heard you guys also use torrents, analyze the torrents, like, you know, before, like, you know, downloading a movie, in order to also, like, to make appearance on, and how is, like, you know, gray that area when you go for, like, you know, everyday and all that sort of
Part of our business is, and the most challenging part for us to work with is the creative side of things. I mean, these teams are really, really telling us we're not sure about data and things like that. But one area that we can really help them with is acquisitions. So in the same way as studios, we go to the LA to buy new series, and then sometimes you have to buy for a package of them. You want to buy the IT crowd, but then within the package you have many more that you don't even know about. And sometimes to really get a good price or good value from it, we tend to go for torrents and say how we can predict a success in the UK from previous series that we, you know, were kind of at this volume of torrents activity downloading. And we can kind of predict that happening for the new series. And really try to help the acquisition team with a value, with a cost they have to pay for it.
Okay, I think we should stop here. And I'll have a couple of minutes to change to the next time. Okay. So thank you all the speakers.